Today, the goal for discussion is to talk about sequences first, and then convex functions and convex sets. How many of you have heard the term sequence before? Okay, good. So this is just going to be a recap of something you've already studied. So I have a sequence, xk. K goes from 1 to infinity. This is a subset in Rn. Okay, so it's an infinite sequence. You start from x1, go all the way up to x infinity. We say that the sequence converges to x xk converges to x bar if and only if for every epsilon greater than 0 there exists an n epsilon in n such that norm of xk minus x bar is less than epsilon for all n, for all k greater than equal to n epsilon. Let's look at some examples. So xk equals to 1 over k. What does this sequence converge to? What does 1 over k converges to as k goes to infinity? Somebody should be able to answer this. 0. So our claim is that xk, which is equal to 1 over k, it converges to 0. So let's try to figure out if it fits within this particular definition or not. So xk minus 0 equals to 1 over k. I want this to be less than epsilon. So which means if k is greater than 1 over epsilon ceiling, which I can define as my n epsilon, then 1 over k is always less than epsilon, right? So for every epsilon greater than 0, I am able to find an n epsilon such that for all k greater than n epsilon, xk minus 0 is less than epsilon, okay? Any questions so far? Is this the definition all of you are familiar with for convergence of sequences? Okay. Why do we care about sequences in a cybersecurity class? Why should we care about sequences in this class? Well, it turns out that as you are collecting information from the surrounding, from the environment, from the sensors, you are trying to come up with a detection. You have a detection algorithm, and that detection algorithm is coming up with some sequence of what I would call test statistics. So test statistics is something we will figure out. We'll talk about it maybe 3 to 4 weeks from now. But so what happens is the detection algorithm is looking at all the data that is coming in, and it's trying to come up with a construct a sequence, xk. And we will call xk as test statistics. And typically, if the test statistics is going to 0 or something close to 0, we say that there is no attack. And if test statistics is converging to something which is a high value, above zero, then we will typically say that there is an attack. We'll raise an alarm that there is something happening with the system. So that's why we care about sequences, because every time we see the measurements, every time the air conditioning system is looking at the temperature measurement, it converts it into some statistic, and that statistic is basically a sequence. So as new measurements comes in, it keeps updating that statistic, and we are looking at the convergent properties of that test statistics to raise an alarm or not raise an alarm. Okay? So that's why we worry about sequences in this class. Let's look at another example. One over log k. So this is a natural log. What does it converge to? One over log k also converges to zero, because as k goes to infinity, log k goes to infinity. And 1 over log k goes to 0. So I have xk minus 0, which is equal to 1 over log k. I'll write it a bit larger. I want it to be less than epsilon. So what should I do? If I pick k greater than, exponential 1 over epsilon ceiling, which I will call my n epsilon, then 1 over log k is going to be less than epsilon. What I'm basically doing is I have 1 over log k less than epsilon. This means 1 over epsilon must be less than log k, which means exponential 1 over epsilon must be less than k. That's how I got this expression. And I'm just going to round it off towards the next integer. So I'm taking the ceiling function here, so I'm rounding it off to a bigger number. And that gives me n epsilon, because n epsilon has to be a natural number. That's how I got this expression for n epsilon. Any question? Okay. Let's look at a picture of a non-convergent sequence, a sequence that doesn't converge. Xk equals to minus 1 raised to k. What is this sequence? If I plot this sequence, this is my k. This is my x0, x1, x2, x3, x4, and so on. So this sequence doesn't converge because it's going down and then up and then down and then up and then down and then up and so on and so forth all the way to infinity. So this is a non-convergent sequence. However, what you will notice is even this non-convergent sequence has a convergent subsequence. So if I just look at the top part of the sequence, it converges to plus 1. If I look at the bottom part of the sequence, it converges to minus 1. So that's known as a subsequence. So subsequences, so this is my original sequence, but I can extract a subset of the sequence, which is x0, x2, x4, x6, x8, and so on. That's called a subsequence. This is typically denoted by xkl, where L goes from 1 to infinity, and K1 is less than is K2 is less than K3 is less than, and so on. So here my K1 is 0, K2 is 2, K3 is 4, and so on and so forth. That's a subsequence. So even though the original sequence doesn't converge, sometimes you can find a subsequence that actually converges. Oftentimes, not oftentimes, but like just for your knowledge, it's a fact, mathematical fact, that if your sequence is bounded, which means that there is a ball and your sequence is within that ball, it's contained within that ball, then you can always find a convergent subsequence, a subsequence that converges to a specific point within that set, within that ball. Subsequences is something that we will not worry about too much in this class, because most of the times we are more interested in sequences, and we are looking at sequences that are either growing to infinity or sequences that are going to zero. So those are the two cases that we will be studying in this class. If it is going to infinity, we'll always construct sequences based on the observations. If the sequence is diverging to infinity, we will raise an alarm. If the sequence is staying within certain bound or going to zero, we will not raise any alarm. We'll say that everything is going fine. There's no problem. So that's all where we will be using sequences, but just wanted to make sure that you understand this fact that you can always construct subsequences out of sequence, and sometimes those subsequences may converge. Any questions so far? Okay. Now I want to talk about convex functions and convex sets. Let's first talk about convex sets. Okay, what are convex sets? So let me give you a pictorial definition. I have a set. I have two sets. I pick two points within the set, and I draw a line, a straight line, okay, between the two points. So I have two points, let me call it A and B, and I draw a line between A and B. This is my another set. I have two points, A and B, and I draw a line between A and B. What is interesting about this set in comparison to this set? The interesting thing here is, no matter which two points you pick and you draw a line, that entire line remains within the set itself. Okay? Here in this particular set, I can find two points, I can draw a line, but it just turns out that sometimes these lines are outside of the boundary. Okay? Maybe some part of the line is outside the boundary. So in this case, only a small portion of this line is outside the boundary. But that's still outside the boundary. Some part of that line is outside the boundary. So sets like these are known as convex sets. And these are known as non-convex sets. So convex sets are sets in which you have two points, you draw a line between the two points, and that entire line will always remain within the convex set itself. So a set X in Rn is convex if and only if for every xy in capital X, for every alpha between 0 and 1, alpha x plus 1 minus alpha y also lies in the set itself. So in this one, this is my x, this is my y, this is my alpha x plus 1 minus alpha y, this point. Okay, so when alpha equals to 0, 1 minus alpha is equal to 1. And so you are looking at y. When alpha equals to 1, then you are looking at x. And for alpha between 0 and 1, you're actually looking at this entire line segment between x and y. And so what I'm basically saying is, no matter which two points you pick, no matter what point within the line segment you pick, that particular point lies in x. Okay? That's convex set. Let's look at an example of a convex set, or maybe not one, but multiple examples of the convex set. This is known as a ball of radius R. Okay? So I'm picking some norm on the space Rn. And then I'm looking at all the x that is within the ball of radius R. So if you look at R2, then this is the unit ball. This is the ball under the L1 norm. So this is a convex set. And you can also look at the usual circle, which is a sphere under the L2 norm, which is a ball under the L2 norm. And so all of these are convex sets. No matter which norm you pick, any of the LP norms, you can pick any of the LP norms. A ball of radius R under that particular norm is always convex set. So A and B are vector, and whenever I write A is less than equal to X is less than equal to B, what I mean is I'm looking at the ith component of X, and it should be greater than AI and less than BI. This is known as a box. This is called box. This is called sphere. Not sphere, actually, ball. Let's look at the third example. And let's look at the fourth example. So these are all important examples of convex sets. An important fact about convex sets is as follows. X1, Xn are convex. This implies intersection of these sets. Is also convex. So you take two convex sets, you take the intersection, it's also a convex set. So you can have any number of convex sets. Take the intersection, you get a convex set. But if you take the union, you won't get a convex set. Okay, so let's look at an example. X such that norm of X is less than or equal to R. And AX is less than or equal to B. If this is my set, this set actually is intersection of two sets and therefore it's a convex set. So this is a convex set. This is a convex set. Remember, I have this constraint here, which is AND. So this needs to be satisfied, and this also needs to be satisfied. So that means it's an intersection of two sets. This set is convex. This set is convex. Therefore, this set must also be convex. And if you want to think pictorially what this set looks like, it's basically a sphere. And then you cut the sphere and you look at this particular portion. So this is my AX equals to B line. This is AX less than or equal to B. And this is AX greater than or equal to B. So I look at this particular region. It's a semicircle or semisphere. It's a ball that has been, some part of the ball has been discarded by a straight line. And so you look at this particular region, it's a convex set. Okay, so intersection of two convex sets is always a convex set. Any questions?
Can the remaining part also be a convex set?
See, the remaining part means that you are now talking about intersection of a convex set with a non-convex set. In this case, the remaining part happens to be a convex set also. So AX greater than or equal to B is also a convex set. So therefore, what you're saying makes sense because you're still taking intersection of a convex set and a convex set. But if I have a circle, if I have two balls, one is like this, the other one is like this, then this is the part which is convex, but the other side is not. Any other question? Okay. So after this, I'm going to talk about convex functions. So if there are no further questions, I'm going to erase everything on the board. Yes?
So if we are dissecting the circle with a line, like let's say in a single dimension,
right,
then the chances of both the sections are convex.
See, if it is a line, then below the line is also convex, above the line is also convex.
It is like only two plane, like.
But if it is a curved surface, then that's when you get into issues. Okay. Once again, let's start with the pictorial description of a convex function. So I have x. And I have a function f of x. So this function is a convex function. Why is it a convex function? I pick any two points, x1, x2. I draw the line at the function values. Okay, so this is my f of x1. This is my f of x2. And I draw a line between f of x1 and f of x2. Okay? What is the property of this line? This line is above the function. Okay? So this is my function. And this line that I'm drawing is above the function. Now, no matter which two points you pick, you draw a line. The line is always going to be above the function. And that means it's a convex function. This class of functions are called convex functions. So f is a function from Rn to R for every x1, x2 in Rn, for every alpha between 0 and 1, f of alpha x1 plus 1 minus alpha x2 is less than equal to alpha of x1 plus 1 minus alpha fx2. This is the definition of a convex function. So this is my alpha x1 Let's look at it once again. So I have a function f. I pick any two points, x1 and x2 in Rn. I pick any alpha between 0 and 1. Okay, I can pick anyone, any alpha between 0 and 1. If I look at the function value at alpha x1 plus 1 minus alpha x2, which is this part, this point, it's always less than equal to alpha of fx1 plus 1 minus alpha of fx2, which is exactly this point. So this point is always above this point. This is the function value here, and this is alpha fx1 plus 1 minus alpha fx2. This is the same as saying the line is always above the function. Okay, it's the same thing. Now it's called strictly convex if for every alpha in open interval 0, 1, I have f of alpha x1 plus 1 minus alpha x2 strictly less than one minus alpha fx2. So now the endpoints are not included. Okay, I'm looking at alpha between 0 and 1, so I'm looking at the line segment between x1 and x2, but I'm not including x1 and I'm not including x2. So the endpoints are not included. And I look at the function value, it has to be strictly less than the line, okay? The value on the line. So the line has to be strictly above the function. So this function is actually strictly convex function. Let's look at some examples of convex functions. Okay, Bill, I want to pause here for questions. Any questions so far? No? Okay, so this is a strictly convex function, which means that the line has to be strictly above the value of the function at this point. Okay, so examples. F of x equals to A transpose x, where A is a vector. This is a convex function. However, it's not a strictly convex function because this condition will not be satisfied by this function, F of x. So I pick a positive semi-definite matrix and I define my function f of x as x transpose q of x, q times x. Okay, so remember positive semi-definite matrices are symmetric matrices whose eigenvalues are non-negative. Okay, so they can be zero or they have to be positive. And positive definite matrices, all eigenvalues of that symmetric matrix has to be strictly positive, then it's a positive definite matrix. So f of x equals to x transpose qx, q is positive semi-definite, this is a convex function, but not strictly convex function. F of x equals to exponential of x, this is also a convex function. And this one is a strictly convex function. I have another strictly convex function. When Q is positive definite, then it's a strictly convex function. A simple way to know if a function is strictly convex or not, or convex or not, is to take the second derivative of the function. And remember what we had mentioned, the second derivative is always symmetric. Okay, so we never have to check for symmetry. But if the second derivative is a strictly positive definite matrix, then you are assured that that particular function is convex, strictly convex function. So I'll write it down formally. To check, I look at the second derivative of the function f. If it is positive semi-definite, it's a convex function. This is positive definite, it's a strictly convex function. So I look at the exponential of x, I take the first derivative, it's exponential of x, I take the second derivative, it is exponential of x. Exponential of x is strictly positive. Therefore, this particular function is a strictly convex function. Exponential cannot be negative, right? Because we are not looking at imaginary numbers and those kind of funny issues that might arise in complex numbers. So we are looking mainly at real numbers here. So this is a strictly convex function. Any questions so far on convex functions? What is a cool property of convex function? So a cool property of convex set was, if I look at intersection of two convex sets, we get a convex set. The cool property of convex function is, if I add two convex functions, I get a convex function. Okay, so f1 and f2 are convex. I add them up, maybe f1, f2, f3, f4. I can have like any number of convex functions. I can add them up, it becomes a convex function. So I can add A transpose X plus X transpose QX plus exponential of X, I get a convex function. I don't even have to check, because each individual component is a convex function. Of course, in this case, X is equal to, X is a real number, it's not a matrix. So here X is a vector, X is a vector, X is a real number, X is a vector. So, just wanted to keep that in mind. Questions? Perfect. I think as far as the definition of convex function goes, we are kind of done with convex functions. I hadn't prepared, I thought that there'll be questions in the class, but it looks like you've already done this stuff, so it's mainly a review for you. I'm going to talk about, let me think, I still have 15 minutes. So I want to talk about something. What should I talk about? Let's see. Let's talk about feedback control systems. So I'll talk about block diagrams. Block diagrams. So block diagrams is something that is used for representing feedback control systems. It's also part of ECE 3551, which is a prerequisite for this class. So I'm pretty sure you guys have also seen block diagrams before. So what happens in a block? So this is a system. It takes an input and it produces an output. In signals and systems class, this is an input signal, this is an output signal, and this is a linear system. Okay? So this is known as a block. Now, no matter how complicated the system is, there's always an input and an output of the subsystems that comprises of that particular system. So let me give you an example. This is an air handling unit, which will be somewhere up in the ceiling. The input to the air handling unit, what is the input to the air handling unit? It would usually be in the form of some voltage or current signal, okay? And what is the output of air handling unit? The airflow. So air handling unit actually controls the amount of air that is flowing into this room, how much cold air is being pumped into this room. So the input is some voltage signal or some current signal. Most likely it's going to be a voltage signal. It goes to the air handling unit. The air handling unit has a fan. The fan starts rotating faster and faster or slower and slower depending on what the input is. And then it moves the air inside the room. So that's the output. Let's look at a thermostat. What's the input to the thermostat? What's the input signal to a thermostat? The input is the air around us. Okay, what is the temperature of the air around us? So this air, whatever cold air, hot air, whatever the air is, it's getting close to the thermostat. So that's the input to the system. What is the output of thermostat?
Voltage.
Sorry? Voltage. Yeah, some sort of voltage which sends that information to the air handling unit. So that voltage or current signal is actually the output of the thermostat. Now, how does this whole system work? So thermostat is feeding into the air handling unit. Air handling unit is in turn changing the airflow, which is feeding into the thermostat. So what we have is the system that is composed of each other. And that brings me to the feedback control system. So this is my system one. This is my system two. And some information gets added, subtracted, depends on how the overall architecture of the system is. And so overall, there is an input here. And overall, there is an output of the overall subsystem. So if you look at it from the point of view of this particular room, the overall input is the temperature at which we want this room to be. So it will be 72 or 73 degrees Fahrenheit. Who sets this particular input here of this overall system? It's us. We as human beings set what is the temperature, what is the right temperature for us. So we will set this input, and then this system, these two systems will work together to make sure that the output is as close to the input as possible. So the air handling unit and the thermostat, both of them will work together to make sure that the volt, that the temperature inside the room is close to 72 degrees Fahrenheit, which is what the input to the system is. So this thing is known as block diagram. This basically, this arrow tells you what is the input to the system, what is the output to the system, and how is that output feeding into the system, maybe some other system, maybe that system itself. How does that output feeds and then gets transformed through the block diagrams? Okay, so this is something that typically is taught in 3551. And no matter how complicated system you pick, whether it's an air conditioning unit of a car, whether it's a battery of a car, whether it's a powertrain of the car, whether it's a electric grid, whether it's a transformer substation, whether it's an electric vehicle charger, you can always look at you'll have a very large scale system, you can always look at a small components, and you piece together all those components, put it in an appropriate block diagram with appropriate architecture of what signal is fed to what subsystem, you will come up with an overall block diagram of that complicated system, of that complex system. Whenever there is a lot of feedback interconnection, so this is known as feedback, so whenever there are a lot of feedback interconnections and the system is expected to work without human intervention, it becomes an autonomous system. So this air conditioning unit is a completely autonomous system because somebody set the temperature of this room maybe 20 years ago when the building was first created, and I'm assuming nobody has gone and changed the temperature since then, and the building has been operating. This particular room has had that 72 degrees Fahrenheit temperature ever since for the last 20 years. Not a single person is going around checking the air handling unit and increasing or reducing the airflow. So it's an autonomous system. And you can think about the entire, like all the heating system of the university, all the, I don't know if you know, but there is a generator right next door, McCracken power plant. Have you seen that? Right here near on the way to RPAC. So that power plant is a completely autonomous system. If there is a power loss at this university, that power plant will start generating electricity and it will continue to generate electricity until the power gets restored at the university. Okay? So it's a, but that power plant is actually already running, but it's running at a very small load right now. Like it's generating bare minimum amount of electricity right now. And the moment, you know, let's say there is a power failure or something, especially if there is a power failure in the Wexner Medical Center, which is a very high, what should I say? It's a high, very high importance, yeah. So it has a very high importance. So if there is a power failure there, immediately the power plant will start generating more and more electricity and feed into the Wexner Medical Center or Dries Lab or any of the other university system, university building. So all of that is example of an autonomous system. Now, when you think about the logic that goes behind this autonomous system, so the generator will have a logic about how to ramp up the electricity production in order to meet the power demand. The air handling unit will have a logic, or the thermostat air handling unit system will have a logic about how much air to push inside this room based on what temperature is measured at the thermostat level. If you look at an electric vehicle or even a hybrid vehicle, there will be logic that determines when to turn on the engine, when to use power from the battery, when to start charging the battery, and so on and so forth. There is a whole bunch of logic that is written in within these systems. Now, how do you come up with that logic? Who decides what that logic is supposed to be? Well, it turns out that the logic, what the outcome is, what the outcome we want, is something that the human decides. We want a faster car, we want a slow car, we want a environmentally friendly car, we want, I don't know, a cool car, and so on and so forth. So we decide what the outcome should be, and based on that outcome, there are engineers, control engineers, who determine what that logic is. And typically, there are two, three ways of determining the logic. One is using rules. So rule-based logic was pretty common in early days. So something like a rule will be something like, go and check your home air conditioning system. So your home air conditioning system is typically fairly simple air conditioning system. So the rule-based logic would be that, let's say your temperature set point is 72 and you are on the cooling side. So if it goes below 71, no, if it goes above 73, it'll turn on the AC and the AC will start pumping in cold air. And when it goes below 71 degrees Fahrenheit, as soon as the thermostat senses that the temperature is below 71 degrees Fahrenheit, it'll turn it off. And that's how it's maintaining the temperature at around 72 degrees Fahrenheit inside your room. So that's a rule-based logic. So you've created a rule: above 73, turn on the AC; below 71, turn off the AC. That's the only rule. There are only two rules in that particular thermostat. So that's the rule-based control logic. This is something that you just kind of cook up in your head and then you just code it in the thermostat. That's it. And those thermostats are what, like, I don't know, $5, $10 thermostats, because it has only two rules. That's it. Then there is a linear, there is a control logic through Laplace domain analysis. So this is a bit complicated, where what you do is you come up with the control logic based on some information about the system. How does the system evolve? So you will think about the thermal modeling of this room and you will say, well, it kind of looks like this room is a first order system. It has this sort of behavior, so x dot equals to something, something. And then you take the Laplace transform and then you do the design of the control logic based on P or PI or PID controller. And that is something that's done in ECE 3551. This is the subject of 3551. And the third one is state space based controller. So in state space based controller, you have, so this one is for a very simple system, this one is for a little bit more complicated system. But basically here the idea is that your system equation can be written in the form of a differential equation, a simple differential equation. Now, if you have a more complicated differential equation, then you have to go through the state space controller design, which is the subject of, if I'm not mistaken, ECE 5551, and then 6750, and then 6754, and so on. So this is something we don't teach at OSU. It's kind of something that's in your head. This is something we teach at an undergraduate level. Then we get to the graduate level courses and we talk about state space based controllers. And then the fourth one would be optimization based. This is ECE 5500, 6500, 8851, and so on. So there we try to have some optimization index and we are trying to design a control law that optimizes some behavior, optimizes some metric. Okay, so this is something we study at the PhD level and early, like late master's level. We talk about optimization-based controller. So what I will do is I'll give you examples of these rule-based controller. We'll talk a little bit about optimization-based control design techniques. And then we'll get into statistics and probability. We'll do a long review of probability and statistics before talking about attack detection. Thank you so much for your attention.